this was a week where COVID deaths hit 700,000 in the United States, more than the number of Americans killed during World War II, more than were killed in the Civil War, more than the Spanish flu killed in 1918, but not more than the number killed by heart disease. Hell yeah, trans fats, undefeated. This week also confirmed, this is grim, no. What we all imagined was probably true, but like now we know it's true. COVID and the Delta variant specifically are disproportionately killing conservatives and driving some to call the pandemic red COVID, right? So this is from the New York Times saying, since Delta began circulating widely in the U.S., COVID has exacted a horrific death toll on red America. In counties where Donald Trump received at least 70% of the vote, the virus has killed about 47 out of every 100,000 people since the end of June. According to Charles Gaba, a healthcare analyst, in counties where Trump won by less than 32% of the vote, the number is about 10 out of 100,000. So visually, this is the graph. Mm-hmm. The Biden counties are pretty low down there. And there's a bunch of other sort of clusters of graphs where you can kind of see like all the red is up here, all the counties that voted. And so like it's like dividing communities directly. Trump counties are obviously far less likely to be vaccinated, even though Trump himself is vaccinated once again, even though his base hates that. So a Pew Research poll last month found that 86% of Democratic voters had received at least one shot, compared with 60% of Republican voters, which I'm already like, oh, okay, 60, okay, not fast enough, but like more than I imagined. The political divide over vaccinations is so large that almost every reliably blue state now has a higher vaccination rate than almost every reliably red state. David, what's the strategy here from like a political perspective? Like, why do you want your base to die? You know?
Well, I mean, I think one element of the strategy, at least originally, was if we don't get the pandemic under control, then that's going to reflect on the person in the White House. Blue state residents, because they are disproportionately worried about COVID, as we've seen, even when they're vaccinated, they tend to cocoon when there are outbreaks. Mm-hmm. And that has an effect on the economy and on spending, consumer spending. And so you will get a stunting of the growth of the economy if you manage to have this continued outbreak. And so it's not really killing the dudes in your base necessarily just so, you know, Biden can look bad. But I mean, that's kind of where we're headed. There is no question that it was not Afghanistan that brought down Biden's poll numbers in July and August. It was the Delta variant.
Yeah. I mean,
you can track that pretty clearly. And so as strange as the strategy is, you could talk yourself into an argument that it's actually worked.
Mm.
And so where does that leave you?
The blame's falling on Biden.
Because the blame is falling.
We literally just threw death at Biden and he took it. It's so nuts. I keep wondering how many people would still be alive if they had called it like the Trump vaccine. Because remember, he wanted credit for it. He wanted it and because he knew it was good and it was effective. And then the companies were like, no, we're not calling it that. No one's calling it that. And then he flipped on it and didn't get credit for it. And now they're just shooting themselves in the head trying to not take it.
Yeah, Trump Lara. I'm like, now that we're on COVID vaccine names instead of Pfizer. Yeah, Trump Lara. Tying shoes. You know, after taking Trump Lara, I felt better than I felt in years. Energy. And my husband's remarked the same. Anyway, sorry, I don't know. I'm imagining what it would be like. Here's my thing about the MAGA mentality. Look, you can't pretend to be concerned about the decline of the so-called white race while staying committed to killing it. All right. You can't say things like immigrants are taking our jobs when immigrants are literally helping you survive in hospitals and saving your lives. So you can get back out there and tell them to go back to where they came from. Right. Like, I feel like if you got COVID at this point and you're a MAGA like diehard, you're out of the xenophobia game. Like, you gotta be out. This has gotta be that moment for you.
Pick a lane, guys.
Right. But it's upsetting. And I mean, I don't have, like, I had a run-in with a hairstylist this week in LA, which is like the exact person that doesn't get vaccinated in this this fucking county. And I was just like, it's just so disappointing. But I don't have very many anti-vax like relatives in red states. And it's hitting, it's not fair. It sucks. Like, it's awful. It's hitting the South real bad. And I, you know, as much as like I want to make fun of it, especially the like AM, you know, anyone who propagandized around, you know, vaccine, like conspiracy theories, like fuck them to forever. I really don't care. But people shouldn't, you know, have to be who've been propagandized to. I think that's awful. And there's a question of why, like, right. Like, and I was reading this article interview, with Rebecca Onion in Slate magazine, talking to this political scientist, Angie Maxwell, who wrote this idea that like wrote a book about the idea that there's a Southern inferiority complex among the white South, of feeling like we're being criticized. Now we're just going to lean into that criticism. Like, yeah, we are the worst, you know what I mean? Or something like that. And she kind of goes in, it's like a really interesting interview, but then she ends it with basically like, I don't know if that's exactly what's going on when it comes to getting vaccinated or not. Instead, she's like, the only thing that's going to work is mandates. She says, I don't usually like government mandates, and I think they should be rare, but I feel like a mandate in this case is a way for people to save themselves. A lot of these people are marks of a con, and a mandate, as much as they may hate you for it, could very well save their life and save the lives of others. In the South, there are some things the government has had to force to make happen. There's a backlash to that, a resentment, which is why I say that mandates should be rare. But on something like this, where it affects other people, mandates are the way.
Yeah, I mean, I think that there is a sense that conservatives kind of wanted Biden and the Democrats and various states and localities to put forward a mandate.
Right.
Because it plays into their sort of victimhood strategy of you're forcing this, these things that we don't want, you're forcing down our throats. Now, mandates are very successful on vaccines. I mean, we saw this. There are a lot of stories in the last week or so, like 300 people at United Airlines were fired because of vaccine mandate. United Airlines has like 100,000 personnel. So, mm-hmm. you know, 300 is a very, very small portion that isn't accepting, you know, however grudgingly accepting a mandate. So mandates are successful, but they allow conservatives to write a narrative that says Biden is forcing something, forcing you to do something to your body that you shouldn't, that you don't have to do. You can't make your own choices. And it plays into sort of their larger narrative.
Yeah.
About the nanny state, about, you know, big government and so on. So
state literally trying to keep you alive.
Right. At this point,
people should have the personal choice to drive drunk.
I mean, that's where the libertarian mindset leads you to.
And it's not there's a very that famous far down the mindset. It's like two stepping stones there.
There's a famous YouTube video of the libertarian presidential debates. Yes.
Oh, it's so good.
Where
I
it's
love
like,
every one
should
of those.
There be seatbelts in cars? And they're like, hell no. And then Gary Johnson actually ends up getting the libertarian nomination. He goes, seatbelts in cars? I don't know. I think we should have that. And he's totally booed.
What is Aleppo? Oh, Gary Johnson. But
you know, Republicans would be like, you know what? It's taking jobs from these body scrapers. These guys who scrape bodies off the road. They're hardworking.
So true. And exactly like seatbelts. If it weren't a law, you bet your ass that broadly, not beyond the Libertarian Party, it would be a talking point among most of the right wing if it weren't a law. So it's like, so would drunk driving. It'd be any sort of semi-culture war terrain they can fight on, they're going to take it. Right. So it's like, well, then lay down a fucking law, lay down a mandate, and people will begrudgingly follow it. And then you have the most crazies, the libertarians are like, you know, no, that shouldn't be. But I totally agree with you. And even in California, like healthcare workers were only like 70 to 80% vaccinated. And then once, you know, Kaiser, et cetera, and other folks like instituted a mandate, we went up to like 97% vaccinated. So they do work, and you can always blame the government. Yeah, blame the government, dude. At least you're keeping people safe, you know?
What you're saying, it always makes me think about how hard it would be to do just like basic societal things nowadays. Like just imagine trying to pitch the idea of libraries nowadays. Mm-hmm. Like if that hadn't existed for already 500 years, you like people would be like, you are out of your mind. What? You're taking money from bookstores.
Books?
You just, people
what do you do with them?
What are you talking right. about? Or there's even seatbelts or anything. It's just, there's no common sense that like to yeah. push through.
Fortunately, we grandfathered some of these things in yeah. before the culture war got
it
going.
It just snuck in barely.
Totally. But if you talk about taking away Medicare, woo, Social Security, woo, they're popular. Libraries, not popular. If there was some way to make libraries more.
How are they not popular?
I mean, they. I guess
among
so.
The people who use them, they're quite popular.
I like, you look, if someone has an academic.edu library access, I would love that. I'm just putting it out there. I really would. Like if you got a JSTOR account, a LexisNexis, holler at your girl. Other than that, I don't really know. Like it's mostly a place for like open mics and feeding ducks. I mean, that was my library, you know?
I love like, open mics and feeding ducks. So,
well, not everyone has Dang this it. Tricked out setup here. yeah. And people who don't have internet access can go to a library and get
For sure. Support your local librarians. I have a good friend who works in the SF Public Library, which is an amazing library. What's going on, Frantifa? If you haven't already, subscribe to this channel right now. Hit that button. And also, you can become a patron and support the show every single week. Get access to bonus episodes and exclusive merchandise. Patreon.com/bituationroom. Do it.